Our scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 5, and I'm going to start reading at verse 1. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for a feast of the Jews. Now there is in Jerusalem near the Sheep Gate a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. Here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." At once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. This is the word of God for us this morning. We had a bit of an incident in the Parks family this past week. On Thursday morning, Helen was working out at the rec center and doing one of the maneuvers with a step thing. She kind of missed it and put all her weight on her ankle and twisted her ankle. And so it was the 5:15 workout, and we got her home on the couch. Helped get her leg elevated and got a towel and some ice for her and put that on there and start helping take care of her. I got her some pain reliever. Most importantly, I got her cup of coffee so that she could relax there on the couch and get ready for the day. Later, she was getting ready. I had to, you know, feed the kids, get the kids all ready for school, and try and get myself ready, and then get everybody loaded up into the van, get the kids to school, get Helen here, help her into her desk. And then Holly came in with crutches so that Helen could get around a little bit. Marcy and Sonia were taking care of every little thing that Helen needed, you know. And Helen will tell you, she's not good with pain. She doesn't have great tolerance, so she didn't want to get up for anything. She just wanted to sit in her seat, and if she needed something, she'd holler for us to come and get it for her, you know. And it felt like if it was just right out of her reach, she'd call me to run down the hallway and get it, you know. She was just really needy on Thursday, you know, wanting us to take care of everything, which is understandable because it's tough when you have that kind of pain. She's feeling better, but she wanted to put her leg up, so she moved over there even this morning. So, you know, it's tough when we have to rely on other people. We don't like to do that, do we? Do we like to be needy? Who likes to be needy in here? Anybody? First service. There you go. She likes it. She likes being needy. And of course, I love serving her. So, you know, it was a joy to be able to do that for me, you know. But we think being needy is a negative thing, isn't it? And I was thinking about that as we are looking at three core questions these next couple of weeks. Core questions for us personally, but also for us as a church to look at as well. We're going to be looking at this question of why do people need the church? And that's church with a big C, the Christian church all around the world. Why do people need the church? Why is there a church? And we'll look at how we can answer that. Another question, why do we need this church? Why do people need this church of St. Paul's United Methodist Church in Williamsburg? Why are we needed? And this morning, we're going to look at the question of why do we need Jesus? Why do people need Jesus? Did you hear all the neediness in those questions? Why do we need the church, need this church, need Jesus? There's a lot of neediness in those questions. And so to me, that makes it a tough question to answer because we don't like to be needy. Needy is a negative thing. We don't want to rely on other people. We are taught by our culture to be strong individuals. Take care of yourself, every man, woman, child for themselves. Pull yourself up by your bootstraps. If you rely on somebody else, if you need somebody else or something else, well, then you're just kind of weak, aren't you? You're weak if you need somebody else. And so we're taught to be self-sufficient, to take care of ourselves. And so to say that we need Jesus can rub some people the wrong ways. They don't want to need anybody. We don't want to be needy. And yet I believe that we all are needy, aren't we? We just don't like to admit it. And so we want to look at these three questions, and this morning especially, why do people need Jesus, and kind of wrestle with it and figure out how would we respond if someone asked me, how would you respond if someone said, why do we need Jesus? Why do people need Jesus? What's the point of that? Do we really need him, or can we just do okay without him? How would you respond? At first, and especially years ago, I probably would have just responded with some Bible passages, some scripture, which I think are good. They tell us a lot. But if someone's not sure they believe in Jesus, why would they believe in what the Bible says? I don't think they would put much weight in that. But I love what Romans says about this. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God," meaning that we're all broken. We all cannot do this thing called life on our own. We all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. We were made to be in relationship with God, but we've broken that. We've messed that up. All of us have done that. That passage tells us. But then in Romans 6:23, it says the wages of sin is death. So if we all have those sins, we all have death coming, not life. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, his Son. And so even though we've all sinned, we've all made that mistake, we've all been broken, the gift that God gives us is eternal life. We have new life, full life in Jesus when we turn to him. And so this answers the question, but probably wouldn't be what someone might listen to if they don't really believe what the Bible says and they want to know still why do they need Jesus. But it says that eternal life is the thing. A lot of times we interpret eternal life just to mean, well, I have my ticket to heaven now, right? I get out of hell because God has given me this ticket to heaven, and I even know some Christians that live this way, so I'm just going to hold my ticket and wait, and we punch that ticket at death, right? So when we die, we hand our ticket in, Jesus punches it and lets us into heaven. And that's why we need Jesus, is so that we can get into heaven, which is accurate, but not really what God intended, I don't believe. God doesn't want us just to sit here and wait for death so that we can go on to eternal life in heaven. To me, it's kind of mean to say, hey, here's a gift, just don't open it. Right? Just hold this gift until you die, and then you can open that gift. It's a pretty gift. It's a wonderful gift. Nice bow on top. Just don't open it. If you did that to a child, would they really appreciate that? If you gave them a gift, said, just don't open that, you know? Just save it for years and years and years, hopefully. And they wouldn't like that at all. They want to open it up. And I don't believe God intended to say, here's a gift of eternal life to be opened later. I think he said, here's your gift. Open it now and experience full life now. And so God wants us to do that. And we need Jesus if we want full life now. And that's where I see in this passage. And this is kind of where I would go if I were maybe going to answer this question of why do people need Jesus. I might look at this passage in John 5. Wonderful story of Jesus. And he's at this pool, this gathering of water. And I'm not sure if scholars know if it was like a stream that was made into a pool or if it was live springs. Some thought it was springs that filled this pool with water. But it was there in Jerusalem, and the story was that when this pool moved, when there was movement in the water, whether that was a current or bubbles or something in this pool would, most of the time it was still, but it would move. And when it did, if you were the first person into that water, you would be healed. If you were the first person to get in there, you would be made whole. You'd be made well. And so because of that superstition, that story, all these sick people, all these unhealthy people have gathered around the pool just waiting to get in. And it only worked for the first person. The second, third, fourth person in the water, they don't get healed. Just the first one. That was the story with this pool. And so Jesus is there among the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. And there's this man, called him an invalid, which probably pointed to that he was healthy, but something happened 38 years ago, some illness or injury that caused him to be weak and not be able to care for himself, and he's not able to get to the pool. And so he's sitting there, and Jesus comes up to him and asks, "Do you want to be made well?" Which is not a great question, I don't think, because he's sitting at this pool where people are healed. Isn't that what he wants, is to get well? That's why he's there, right? Why else would he be sitting at this pool where people are healed? He's there to get well. And so, I probably would have been a little insulted. Jesus, well, of course that's why I'm here, Jesus. Why else would I be at this pool? I want to get well. But he doesn't do that. He says, yes, I do, but I can't get into the pool. Every time it stirs, somebody else gets in there before me. I need somebody to help me so that I can be the first person into the pool to be healed. He's kind of needy, isn't he? He needs somebody to help him get in there so that he can be healed. And Jesus says, well, just get up, pick up your mat, and walk. And the man does that. He is instantly healed by Jesus. A life that he'd been waiting for 38 years, that he had hoped this water in this pool was going to give to him, but it never gave it to him in 38 years. Jesus just speaks to him. Get up, pick up your mat, and walk. And his life is completely changed and transformed. He's made whole again. He's healed. He's given back his health. And as I look at that story, I see all of us in that story. And I see this story really showing us why someone might hear why they need Jesus. It's because when Jesus can make you whole. Jesus can heal you. He can take that brokenness, that hurt, that desire for wholeness, and he can heal you. That's what Jesus can do. Because I think we all really are like that man laying there by the pool. We're all like that man, wanting to be healed, wanting to be made whole, but something is missing, something is not right in our lives, and we're searching for something that will just kind of fix it all, and we kind of tell ourselves, well, I'm going to find one of those magic pools. I'm going to find something, and that thing is going to make my life whole. It's going to make my life complete. If I just find that one thing, everything will be better, right? And so we find that different things. Maybe it's a boy or a girl. Maybe there's this relationship. If I just had that person, if that person would love me, everything will be fixed. Everything will be better, and I'll be made whole by that one person. And so we chase that pool, and we hope that it'll heal us. But oftentimes, well, all the time, it doesn't. But then we say, well, what if I had this right job? If I had this job and I had the right work, if I just get that, everything in my life will be better. It's another pool we're going to chase, and we're going to try and fix ourselves by finding that thing because we're going to do it ourselves. We're not going to need anything else, but it doesn't work. Or if I have enough money, if I just get this much in my bank account, if I have this big a house, if I have all these things that I need, then I'll be made whole if I just get those things. And so we chase all these magical pools that are going to fix everything, but they don't. It doesn't work. It's just superstition. It's just a story that if I get that, but we have that desire within all of us. Every person has that. And it's because we were created to be in relationship with God, and we've broken that relationship. We think we can find another way to quench that desire inside of us, but it's only through Jesus that it's quenched. And so I say that's why we need Jesus, because when we look to him, we finally say, I am needy. I want to be made well. Then Jesus will make us well. Jesus will make us complete and whole. That doesn't mean everything's fixed, everything's perfect, but I believe that calms that thirst within us. It gives us joy and hope and peace that we've been desiring, that we haven't found in all the other things we've been chasing. But Jesus does that. He heals us and makes us whole and complete again. And so that's why we need him, because we're chasing all these different things, when all we need to do is just turn to him and say, I need to be made well. He didn't say, okay, well then get up and go get in the pool. Jesus just said, get up, you're made well. Just instantly healed him. And I think God will do that to us. He will meet that thirst, that desire within all of us as he becomes a part of our lives and connects with us, gives us the gift of eternal life, is living life to the fullest here and now and not waiting to punch our ticket later. And so when I think about answering that question, that's the way I think about that we are hurting. We're chasing different things, and we just need to know that Jesus is the thing that we need to chase. Jesus is the one that can make our life whole and complete again. So I wouldn't quite say to someone, well, it's because you're sick and Jesus is the cure. I wouldn't quite say it that way to someone, but I definitely would say, I have found in my life that I've been chasing all these things. I've been wanting to fill my life with different things to find happiness and joy and peace. But when I get those things, no matter how many people I'm friends with, no matter how successful I am, no matter how many of my dreams come true, there's always been something missing. There's always been something missing. I haven't been whole, even when I got the things I wanted, until I turned to God. And I said, God, I can't find it. I can't find what I'm looking for. Maybe it's you. What can you do? And it's when I turned to Jesus that finally I felt like I had everything I needed. Finally, I felt whole and complete. The things I've been chasing were just things that I thought might heal me when Jesus was the one that did heal me and make me whole again. And so that's why I believe I need Jesus, and I'm needy, and that's why I believe others are needy as well, and they need Jesus as well, because they're still chasing all these different things, and they're never going to be satisfied until they grab on to the one who will heal them and make them whole. And so I pray as we see people chasing, that we'll answer that question. You know why you need Jesus? Because he makes you whole now. He heals you. He fills you up. He satisfies those longings that you're trying to satisfy by running to all these different places, all these different relationships, all these different things that you've set above other things. If you just turn to him, you can stop chasing that stuff. Now, you still can go on and be successful and set goals and things, but that won't fulfill you. That won't complete you because you're already complete because of the love of Christ that is in your life. And so we need him to make us whole and to satisfy our longings, to give us that eternal life that we can live here and now. That's why we need him. And that's why we are needy for a God that created us to be in relationship with him. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you that your son comes to give us eternal life. Lord, we long for so many different things, and we think that those things will make us happy, but they're only temporary. Only for a little while will they satisfy those needs. And Lord, sometimes we can fake it pretty good too, and we pretend like it's all that we need. But you are the only one that we need. You are the only one that can make us whole and complete. And so help us to recognize our need for you, and then also be willing to share that need with others around us, that they too can know your peace and your joy in their lives here and now as you give them full life. We pray this all in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.